some small goof up where we haven't got the presentation. So probably I can send it to you or I can post it on the net and you can access it. Unlike most of the sessions today, what we saw, I'm going to talk about something different and not about security. I'm going to talk about some key learnings during organizational change. This could be some major organizational changes like security transformation programs. Now, all of us have gone through some organizational change, I'm sure. We call it multiple names. Some call it total quality management. Some say re-engineering. Some say restructuring, while the others say resizing. Essentially, all these are organizational changes, think by think. I have been through some of them. I've learned some lessons the very hard way. But the most important lesson that I've learned is remembering the basic goal of the change. What I mean by that is, when we start with any change, we start with a business requirement, a business need. But while we make the change, we tend to get so engrossed in the change process that we lose sight of the business requirement. A simple example would be, while making a change, you come across a situation where there is a small obstacle which has not been anticipated. And you have two options. One, take the change management process as a mandate and just go with that. Or bring in a small element of flexibility which will realign this process looking at the business requirement. So that's the time when a little flexibility might help. In the following slides, I have some eight key things that I have learned, and I've aligned my thoughts to a book by John Otter. If you would have read, you'd probably see the resemblance. The first thing that I have learned is establishing a sense of urgency. Why now? Why is the change required now? Absence of this urgency will definitely not get you adequate attention, audience buy-in, their commitment, seriousness, and absolutely no acknowledgement. What we say when we make a change is, what is the change that we want? How is it going to impact others? What are the benefits? But we talk very little about why we require the change now. If why now is stressed with adequate justifications, facts, figures, some supporting evidence, it will not only bring the audience attention to the project, but it will also alert them on why the change is important to succeed. So the first thing is establishing the urgency. The second thing is getting some key senior people to commit to the change. Can we drive an organization change all by ourselves? Yes, we can. If we are the CEO and we have the entire steering committee and XCOM committee reporting to us, we just need to tell them and the change will happen. But otherwise, it is important for a successful change that we have some key people involved in the entire organizational change process. Without the core team, the change management process is likely to fail in the beginning or probably sometime after it begins. The individual needs to collaborate as a team and act as a virtual arm to the change owner. This will lead the change for you and help you articulate your message downstream. A larger audience can now also be accessed because you have more number of people with you. So getting key senior people is very important for organizational change. The third thing is giving everyone a vision. What is it for you? You need to show them what benefits will the change have on them. How will it impact them? Or how their help in the change process will impact the overall organization. Just telling everyone what the change is and what you expect from them is probably going to get you more resistance than support. So please remember, change is a threat when done to us, but an opportunity when done by us. And threats are always resisted, whereas opportunities are always embraced. So giving a vision for everyone is important. The fourth is communication of this vision. In any organization, the change procedure, the most impacted individual is an ordinary employee. Traditionally, changes are made, whether designed, implemented, and the employees are then informed somewhere, which is okay for certain type of changes, but not all. For large organizational changes, if you make the larger audience anticipate what the change is going to be and how it is going to impact them much before the change is implemented, then such changes tend to get more accepted. Communication of the change and to the change must be across all individuals, not just to the core senior team members, but across all employees. More important here is having as much as one-to-one communications as possible instead of one-to-many. So instead of emails, broadcasts, announcement, see if we could talk to more people and bring a cultural discussion in the audience. The fifth is empowerment of the vision. We expect some key people to help us in bringing in organizational change, but we want to be little control freaks and not give them some controls. We are scared. Empowerment to key individuals with discretionary powers is very important in larger organizational changes. This will not only encourage them to manage their own obstacles, but they will ensure that the project doesn't get stalled or delayed and will act in our support. These additional powers could be temporary, but the effects are long-lasting. The sixth is planning for and creating short-term goals. What is usually seen is a decrease in momentum because of decrease in enthusiasm, in efforts over a period of time due to various reasons. To ensure that the operational changes do not halt or slow down drastically, the easiest thing that one can do is create short-term wins. Short-term wins provide a sense of achievement and helps one to continue the enthusiasm for the remaining change. One must not forget to recognize the individuals who are involved in the changes and must award them. After all, they are the ones who are going to continue the change for the later part. The seventh is using the momentum to maximize the change. Now, let's say the changes are being implemented successfully. You are seeing that changes are happening. When the momentum is high, do not put the process on an autopilot mode and relax. This is one of the major cause of failures I have experienced myself. Once we have a fair success and see the change being implemented and accepted, we tend to slow down a bit. Instead, look at it as a window of opportunities to push in maximum change that you can. Maybe you might not get such an opportunity in this cycle. Hence, using the momentum to maximize the change becomes very important. Finally, what you have done needs to be institutionalized. You see that the change has been implemented, a new process is being run. That's where the outcome of these changes need to be institutionalized, either as a policy, procedure, a culture, whatever suits the organization. Integration of new processes with the surrounding processes and mapping the overlaps becomes really important at this point in time. There is also a need for monitoring the changes and assuring the stakeholders that yes, the changes are actually in effect now. This becomes your business as usual process. I think that's what I had, the eight things. So just to summarize, first is establishing an urgency for the change, why now? Getting senior people commit, giving a vision to all, communication of the vision to everyone, preferably one-on-one, empowering people to act on their vision with some discretionary powers, creating short-term wins, using the momentum to maximize the changes, and finally institutionalizing new approaches.